better words. So as you just heard, I'm a surgeon across town at Mass General Hospital. And I, in some ways, for me personally, I think I have the coolest job. You know, I get to help people during my clinical work. And then I also get to think about ways, how can we change medicine and how can we help those that we can't help today. So in the next few minutes, I'll introduce you to a field of medicine that I think will touch all of our lives and will become relevant to all of us as this evolves. Mm-hmm. The good news, as you just heard, and this talk is fantastic. The last talk was a beautiful introduction into longevity. The good news is, if you come to see me or my peers and care providers, you very likely have a problem that can be fixed. Right? You develop pneumonia, broken leg, trauma, or even in my case, lung cancer, airway stenosis. You come, we have a patch, we have a way to fix you up. You get back out there, you get back to your life, and that's what everybody wants. The irony is, and I recognized that when I started training, if you come to me with end organ failure, say it's heart failure or kidney disease, I can put you on a wait list, and I can say I'll give you a call 5 years from now when there's an organ available, right? Because there's this huge gap between donor organs that are available that are in the thousands and the millions of patients that suffer from end-stage organ disease. If we then think what's going to happen to you in those 5 years is you're going to receive treatments that have changed these diseases from a death sentence to a chronic disease. And by the way, this will apply to chronic diseases, as you heard, will apply to 3 out of 4 in this room, and 1 out of 4 of us will eventually have single system failure that needs a transplant. During those 5 years, you're going to be attached to machines, you're going to have engineered organ replacements, so your quality of life is going to be poor, you're going to cost a lot to the healthcare system, and you're not going to be able to live your normal life, and in the end, your lifespan or your longevity is going to be limited. In many instances, to a point where you don't actually receive a transplant organ because you couldn't wait that long. When I started to think about this, I realized, well, maybe we can find a different solution, right? And what's exciting about organ engineering is that so many fields of research right now, in this moment, are converging and are bringing all these components to clinical reality, and I'll talk about that a little bit. So if we look at your organs are made out of two components, cells and extracellular matrix. Right? This is, for example, the functional unit in your kidney that makes urine. And every one of you has about 1 million of these glomeruli, they're called. And these are the cells that fulfill the biologic functions, right? The higher level functions, the little machines that, in this case, remove toxins and create a filtrate. And they're held in place by a framework, very similar to a building, that keeps them in the right spot and enables their function over your entire course of life. That framework, by the way, is made when you're born, or made up until you're born, and then it grows a little bit, but then it pretty much stays the same. So these fibers that are there to hold these cells in place last for your entire life. So if we think about engineering replacements for organs, this is sort of a good starting point. Now, the good news is, like I said, a lot of fields are converging right now, and one of them is the field of stem cell biology. So this is the groundbreaking work of Shina Yamanaka, who taught us how to reprogram patient cells into stem cells and then drive them back to become the biologic building blocks of tissues. These are actually heart muscle cells that are currently pumping away in a petri dish over in the lab at Mass General, in our lab. So they're cells that have been turned into stem cells and then turned back into functional cells that actually contract and fulfill a function. And this is not just in the future, but thanks to work of brilliant scientists like Doug Melton, some of these stem cells have been turned into cells that fulfill a function. In this case, they produce insulin, and they cured a patient. You might have heard about this in November last year, the first patient off diabetes, by replacing the function that patient had lost. Right? His own immune system attacked the insulin-producing cells, and we were able to replace those cells. So when we think about how can we drive this from cells to tissues, we really have to think about developmental biology. And people like Daryl Cotton over at BU is a developmental biologist. And these people have mapped out how cells decide to become certain cell types and how these cell types then grow into three-dimensional tissue. What you see here, those are lung cells. They turn green when they decide to become lung cells. But you can see in a petri dish, they're basically trying to form structure. That process is called morphogenesis, right? It's something that is a hallmark of our development. When we try to replicate morphogenesis, that process of structure formation, we have to understand or leverage the collective intelligence of cells. You know, Mike Levin over at Tufts put this that way in a discussion recently, and I thought this was really inspiring. You know, if you look at ourselves as we grow, you know, your right hand's the same size as your left hand, right? Or in species like the axolotl, if they have an injury, axolotls are able to replicate that arm or a heart or a kidney, and thereby regenerate themselves. And what's interesting is that cells know how to do that, and they know how to stop and when to stop, right? Because the difference between stopping and non-stopping is basically cancer. So we have to understand those signals. And last but not least, we have to try to replicate the process of morphogenesis in the lab. What you see here, it's a little fuzzy, but you see a heart tube that's seeded with human heart muscle cells that you saw pumping away before, and it's basically placed in a bioreactor that enables us to replicate the mechanical stimuli that that heart tube sees in a developing embryo to undergo what's called the looping that then leads to a four-chamber heart. So the process of manufacturing these living things entails both understanding the stem cell biology and then also harnessing the cell, the collective intelligence, and exposing these tissues to the signals they need to form. Now, with this concept, we build really on giants. You know, it's Jeva Kant and Bob Langer created that field of tissue engineering 30 years ago here in Boston. And it was the simple idea to say, well, if tissues are made out of matrix and cells, can we, in an engineering approach, take a matrix scaffold, put cells on it, and take it through a tissue assembly process to get something that can be transplanted? When I approached this, I was working for Doris Taylor at the University of Minnesota, and the first step in the right direction we made there was to create organ matrices, right? This is a heart that undergoes detergent perfusion, and with that process, we're able to wash out all the cells and isolate that framework, both for use to make tissues, but also to better understand what actually is, what makes that framework and what's its architecture. And when we then seed cells, cardiomyocytes again, onto this matrix, we can reform functional tissue. And now these cells, they're the same cells that are waving on that figure you saw in the very beginning or on that slide. You know, now we're able to reduce these cells and put them in a three-dimensional context where they do work for us, right? In this case, they start to pump, they start to produce work, and that means they're on the right way to eventually form a tissue that can help patients. One can imagine an assembly line at some point, right? This is sort of a mini assembly line over in my lab at MGH, but these are scaffolds that are taken off the shelf, and you seed them with patient-derived cells, in this case, human lung cells. And like I said, you expose them to the stimuli of a developing lung, right? In this case, they're ventilated and perfused over time. And what really inspired me looking at the sections of these lungs is that, and I know this is very abstract, but how similar are these structures to developing lungs? So what you see there on the left is basically a microscopic image of a 25-week fetal human lung in utero, and on the right side, a 10-week engineered lung in a bioreactor. And we see the same distribution of cells, we see the same architecture, you know, these cells start to produce surfactant and behave very similar to the developing organ. So this is a process in the end, it's complicated, but it's a process that can be replicated in vitro or in our labs. The field that really is going to leapfrog this, I think, and back again to fields that are converging right now, is additive manufacturing. You know, thanks to engineers like Jennifer Lewis, Adam Feinberg, and Jordan Miller, we learn how to not only isolate these scaffolds from nature, but make them ourselves, make them to specifications, right? So we learn how to make vascularized structures, we learn how to make organ scaffolds out of matrix material following human design. And in some ways, and this is very inspiring, I think we also learn that, you know, if nature makes it one way, we can maybe even build on that and say, well, can we make something, can we mimic the architecture but do something that works even better? So I think the future we're looking at, and hopefully not too far future, is that eventually we'll be able to combine all these manufacturing processes with stem cell and developmental biology to get to a point where we can make organs to order. And in some ways, as a physician, you dream about a future where you have a first device as a bridge to transplant, a second device as a destination therapy, and a third device in the end, or a more mature device, as a destination therapy that can surpass organ transplants and solve the need for donor organs. So with that, I want to thank you all for letting me talk here, and all the contributors to this field. Thank you.